was a meeting of veterans. Probably the experience that I really made up to several centuries of activism. Astonishing, actually. Anyway, but we get to get down to it because we're into action. Number one, what we want and what we need is a new national strategy / set of principles under which we can be operating under as protesters, activists, and practitioners of non-violent direct action. So, a strategic overview for the whole country. Number two, we decided we'd like to dig up the old Direct Action Network manual and the ADAPT manual that helped America, and we want to rewrite a new direct action toolkit that can be distributed all over the place and get more people recruited, more people to innovate how they do things, and to simply spread protest and direct actions everywhere. Get more people involved, get people empowered. That's it, thanks.
Thank you. Next is Disability Arms and Protest.
So we went through some examples of disability protests through art, particularly the Grimm installation we did at the Tate Modern, where we took over the turbine hall. That was Deepak and PCS. Points, the main points that came through that were there's an event in Westminster, the Palace of Westminster, I presume in the committee rooms, you'll find out more about, actually on disability arts on the 22nd of November at 6 p.m. The two main things that people wanted to do coming from this were a meeting of about six times a year of disabled people around arts and protest. Making art for protest. About 6 meters a year, I presume that would be in London. There was one, the other thing, we main thing we wanted to do was, some of you would have seen on the chairs, Mary Ellen left her information about invisibility, the installation she did, and we were reading from that we'd like to do a real installation of that. Somewhere, possibly in the same room or somewhere, we'll get away with it. And also, people were quite keen on Mary Ellen's hashtag message of a nappy, which is about independent living and making people wearing continence pads when they don't need to, and the practical twists or something around that. Thank you.
Thank you. International solidarity.
Thanks for everyone who attended this workshop. It was a workshop put on very much at the last minute. It didn't go on the original Eventbrite promotion for today's conference. So very well attended workshop, very diverse, very useful discussion and a series of proposals which I'll run through now. Our first one was to check the current situation regarding the moratorium disgracefully brought in by this government back in February of this year that stops Syrian refugee children with disabilities coming into the UK. We want to sort of see what's happening with that campaign, for that to be lifted and to, in order to help do that, to make links with the campaign for the Dubs Amendment, to put pressure on the government for openness, for honesty, and to open the borders and let these children in. We want to call on the organisations of today to work to build to make contact with refugee support organisations, both here and internationally, in order to support the migrants and refugees who are currently in camps in Calais, or not in camps, but out in the open in Calais and Dunkirk, many of whom are disabled, higher and higher instances of self-abuse, self-harm taking place as young children in particular are being left completely destitute out in the open. We want to make sure that those organisations get the support that they need, and we link arm in arm with those in building to get support out to those people in the coming months, but also to raise awareness of the plight of disabled people as migrants and refugees in Calais and Dunkirk and elsewhere. The group also highlighted the need to raise awareness through our networks, particularly through the trade unions and international networks, and the research departments that they've got, and our DPOs, of the plight of disabled people who aren't able to migrate or to seek refuge because they haven't got the resources to get out of the situations that they're in, either fleeing war, persecution, starvation, or disaster caused by famine or drought. And we need to continue to work on that. The meeting also very kindly agreed to support a group of visually impaired people who I'm working closely with, who are fighting for their own rights and independence in Barcelona, but who are linking their struggle for the rights of disabled people with the right for self-determination for the Catalonian people at the moment, and the group kindly agreed to support that call, and I hope the meeting here will do today. And finally, very importantly, we're calling on everyone attending today, and particularly to see if the organisations, the trade unions, the disabled people's organisations, the organisers of today's event, will agree to support a call for a block of disabled people to attend the National Stand Up to Racism demonstration here in London next March, so that we can be as visible as possible, the presence of disabled people and the wonderful diversity that we have here today, to send a message to migrants, to refugees here and across Europe, to our disabled brothers and sisters across Europe and internationally, that we stand united and together against racism, against hate, against oppression.
Don't see your mouth.
Okay, we took Kimberly Renshaw's definition as a starting point, which defines intersectionality as a frame that prompts what falls between movements and what happens when different systems of power and oppression overlap. We then came up with this diagram, which basically looks at the kind of strands of oppression, as you might call them, but then it intersects with many societal issues. So we've kind of got these kind of circular things. So we've got, on the outside of the circle, we've got things like politics, legal systems, war, immigration, globalization, capitalism, for example, and then the kind of strands, like Asian and homophobia, sexism, going on in the world. So that's the kind of way that I'll be doing this in a second. We actually have quite, we first discussed the barriers that people find in, being intersectional, I suppose you might call it. And it was quite interesting. We had a long discussion. We didn't actually do a lot of talk after anything, but we had a long discussion. And then we tried to come up with some campaign ideas. Now, as I said, we know about 20 different things, but I'm just going to go over a few of them. We talked about privilege a lot, and we talked about different communities not having access to information about other intersections. We talked about hierarchy of intersection and sometimes how certain groups have more height, seem higher up the hierarchy than others. It's very difficult to say, so it's very correct. We thought the fundamental thing that we come up with was basically we thought we all need to take a look at ourselves. we all exist with our own different strands, our own different perceptions, but if we cannot see our own privilege, if we cannot see our own, you know, way that we are for people, then we're not going to do anything. We also looked at the idea of bringing back histories and archives, because, for example, we looked for, quite a lot at Black experience, and they have a lot of communities where it's very difficult for information to get through to those communities, and they're kind of quite marginalised. So we feel that having a history and an archiving process that brings the history of Black disabled women and Black disabled men into visibility would be really important and really important for struggle. We also looked at something we call modelling ourselves, which goes back to this looking at ourselves again, and we talked about grassroots culture. So the fact that for a lot of intersectionality discussions, they tend to be done in middle class white environments, and actually the Black environment doesn't.
Excuse me, sorry, yep. I must have a little say. Lots of some of the things that you're saying, we might not all agree with it.
Yeah, okay.
Because some of your terminology is a little bit off.
I'm reporting what the group said.
Thank you. Yeah, please on.
Yes.
Yes, let me know what you said about.
Yeah, we also talked about social media campaign. We talked, excuse me, can I finish? Thank you. We talked about the Me Too social media campaign and some of the problems that people experience with that.
So, can we, okay, so I'm going to say, it's not very good, I don't know if we've managed to do that. But it was still around, we'll talk about this afterwards. Can you continue, please? But Conrad, I'm only asking you to respect the person who is speaking. She's not speaking for herself, she's speaking for a group of people that are also facilitating a particular workshop. Please, have some respect for the person. Thanks.
Put forward the opinions of my group, and I will continue to do so. And I'll just remember a couple more things. We talked a lot about alliances, so building alliances across different groups. And we talked about the idea of alienation, and we also talked about the idea of not yet disabled as a term. That again is not my term, that's the term that we put forward. The idea that this could be something that could be useful in talking about older people and their related benefits and so on. Thank you.
Can I just say that beautiful gifts to this. We can bring these things up in the report, when we do the report, particularly in and around language. We understand it's very important. Today, we've got a discussion here. So I'd like to bring on the next speaker, please. The trade union.
I'm just saying.
Comrade, you're a statement. Trade union organising group, please.
Hi, is that working? Yeah. My name is Robert Slorak. I'm a member of the USCU. I'm the facilitating the workshop for organising the trade union. And I did actually want to pick up on the question of language, because I think that it is something.
Slow down.
My apologies. I did want to pick up on the issue of language, because it is one of the themes which has been recurring through today's conference, and it's something that came up in our workshop as well, which is that not just the Equality Act, but the concept of equality is supposedly being practiced by institutions and by the government. If you go to the Prime Minister's website, for example, it will show you that the government says it supports the social model of disability. However, the problem is the content of equality, the substance of equality, is being hollowed out. And that's something that we find very much in our workplaces, where we have, for example, disability champions and mental health champions. Yet the environment we're working in, the performance management that we find, the productivity drives that we find, the cuts of jobs and services that we find, are meaning that people are having to work harder and faster under much, much more difficult conditions. So that, for example, in my workplace, we have a staff satisfaction survey every 5 years, and we have an interim since the last one. Our HR department has set up a respect agenda. Now, the problem is that actually, since the respect agenda was set up, there is more staff dissatisfaction than there was beforehand, and that's because the environment within which people are working has become much, much worse. So one of the things that people highlighted in our workshop was the need to, for trade unions to concentrate on the things that unify people, to find the themes that are able to get us to work together, and not to fight the things or stress the things that divide us. You know, if you like, we can all fight over the things that unite us, and maybe share over a cup of tea or whatever, have a chat over the things that we disagree about. So I think that the point of this conference, the point of our workshop, was trade unions, or the disability movement, is a collective body. And therefore, if you want to talk about legislation such as the Equality Act, then you need to have organisations that are capable of saying what adjustments are reasonable is what this body is, of people is campaigning to make you accept. In other words, it doesn't become an individualised question, which is the way in which the legislation is framed. It doesn't become a question of whether you can afford to take an employer or service provider to court. It's about what you can fight for in the context of the environment in which you have people around you that you can campaign for common cause around. So really what we were saying in the workshop, sorry, just to try and round this up, is that trade unions need to improve their relevance. And in terms of the way that they can recruit, that's by concentrating on the immediate issues that are threat to everybody in the workplace, either locally or nationally. So that, you know, the campaign over pay at the moment is a campaign for everybody, because we've all been hit by austerity over the last few years. We're all weaker, we're all suffering in the pocket as a consequence of that. So if our unions lead a real campaign, a real fight over the issue, not only is it going to make trade unions much more relevant to people, but it's going to mean a much more emboldened movement that is going to be able to fit to help a Labour government that we all want to see be able to fight for these things, because there is a movement that's actually prepared to fight for these independently of the kind of forces that are going to be brought to bear against a Labour government trying to implement radical policies. So if we want to see these policies implemented, if we want to see the equality agenda implemented, then there isn't a shortcut to that. We have to actually be able to fight for these things in the grassroots and the here and now. And therefore the trade union's job is not just to be waiting for a Labour government, but to make the demands that at the same time make that Labour government more tangible for people by providing hope that is actually based on policies that can be implemented that can make a real difference to our lives.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks.
Somebody left a blue bag in room one. It was after the use of the law system. And if your bag becomes a blue bag, it will be reception, at the main reception. Okay, so we'll go now on to an ultimate workshop using the law.
The priority action that came out of the Using the Law workshop is that we need to take action to increase our knowledge of our rights, but equally importantly, how we then use that knowledge in our lives, whether that's day-to-day, in communication with social workers, or with service providers, or, you know, in big strategic legal action cases. And we thought we have to start from ourselves. I mean, I know a few people have already kind of mentioned the wealth of experience, knowledge and skills in this room. And we thought we have to commit ourselves to sharing what we think would contribute to that increased knowledge about our rights. That might be your personal experience of going through an assessment process, or your personal experience of going through an appeals process, or it could be you know, the legal duties that you collated together as an organisation. There's something that we can all contribute here and share with each other so we are as strong as possible. So very specifically, we thought we could start by asking everybody here to reflect and then commit to sharing what they think can contribute to increasing our knowledge. And maybe, you know, we can set up some kind of hub where we can put information and resources. I know Inclusion London will be absolutely happy to share our resources on the Care Act. It's just one kind of piece of legislation. But also maybe, you know, if you're prepared to speak to somebody who's about to go through an appeals process about what it's like for you, can we actually increase and add support, peer support networks? So those are the kind of practical things that we want everybody here to think about and to commit to.
Thanks, Josie. Okay, and finally, the News in the Media workshop.
Hi, my name's Deborah. We talked about human rights, believe it or not. Something, it's a concept that the mainstream media seems to struggle with slightly. So I know everybody's tired and has to go home, so I'll just do some bullet points. So, hashtag systematic, gross and systematic violation of disabled people's human rights. Hashtag human catastrophe. Hashtag write our own stories and localise and individualise our stories and send them in, because much of the media, they don't want to spend their profits on paying journalists, so there aren't any, or there hardly any to send to everyone. So write your own stuff and send it in. Hashtag access issues. Hashtag the media excludes the deaf and the deaf community big time, and this needs highlighting again and again.
Thank you all for your. This is like that. That was really good. Thanks. And I'm going to start. Now, I'm going to start first before the workshop here, just to say that all those experiences, those ideas will be collated now in a few weeks, and we'll put a report out. This is today going to be the first part of an action, the beginning of the action, I'm hoping. And from once we've got this in place, they can then go out to our unions, to our disabled organisations, and to grassroots campaigns, and indeed to individuals. I'm hoping individuals will draw into one or other of those groupings. And once we've got that together, we'll be looking at setting up a meeting or a campaign in the new year. But we will keep everybody here abreast of what's going on via one form of media or the other. Now, it remains for me now to do a lot of thank yous, because today's been a big day. It's taken quite a bit of setting up and organising. In the first instance, I think I need a thank you from Andy Hudson from the NDU and also from the TUC Disabled Workers Committee. It was named Andy. The summit was managed by idea as recently as July this year, so having got up and running, I think it was quite exceptional. So, Mandy, thank you very much. Now, Mandy's out there, I'll remember thanking you as well, the executive of the union itself, for providing us with the premises and providing the catering. So, thank you on both of those. And for organising the event, I really need massive big thanks to Alan. The only people that are there, Morris, who have spent, I've got an hour, and Alan's spent their fall out on this event, but they really have worked hard to get this up and running and to get it actually occurring today. So I want a massive thank you. I'd like to thank the DSL services as well as the parent judges, also those of VAs, and those VAs and the VAs who are coming with the air to do so. Thank you. The workshop facilitators, the papers, and finally, a massive thanks, of course, to all of us here today, not only for coming today, but what we've been doing in the last number of years. We were visited by this horrendous government and its predecessor, who've gone through, personally, we've got personal testimony of Paul Redmond, and the people who can't be here today, and are no longer with us, driven to the graves by a vicious, unrelenting government. And I just want to thank you all for the last 7 years what you've done, the impact of the spirit of the movement, and you all individually, and hopefully we'll meet up again in a few months to see where we are on the campaign. So solidarity, I think we've got a song. I don't feel a song coming, you don't really hear me sing. We've got a song coming.
Okay, thank you guys for watching this. It's been great. And anyway, I will actually, so hopefully you can join us some other time, and we'll keep you updated. Okay, peace out guys, and see you soon. This is Obi, Occupy News Network, Occupy London, signing off.